I will sing holy. I will sing holy. I will praise the Lamb of God who sits upon the throne. I will worship Him and give a praise to Him alone. You said you will lift up your voice and sing to the one who is on the throne. You will lift up your voice and sing to the one who forever sits on the throne, the Lamb that was slain. Worship Him, give Him all the praise. Give Him all the praise, give Him all the praise, give Him all the worship. Worship His holy name. Worship Him. Worship the Alpha, worship the Omega, the one who was, who is, and who is to come, the ever-present God. the one that gave you the first miracle for today, that made you to see the light of this day, that gave you the opportunity that many are praying and craving for. Many are looking unto God for that same opportunity to be in His presence. For you are here, healed and healthy, and you are alive today. So clap your hands, to lift your voice, to sing. You can move your hands, you can move your legs, you can raise your voice, you can move around. Bless His holy name. Give Him all the praise. That they will worship you. Daddy will give you all the praise. Daddy will give you all the praise. For in Jesus' mighty name we worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Because there is none like you. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. Daddy, you are everything to us. We thank you for today. We thank you for how far you've kept us. We thank you for bringing us far and near to your presence this evening, to come and learn at your feet. That it be exalted in the name of Jesus. That it, as we've come tonight, let the entrance of your word give understanding to our simple heart in the name of Jesus. And let us enjoy your presence. And all glory will be yours. And all blessing will be ours in the name of Jesus. Therefore, we declare this service open in the name of God the Father, in the name of God the Son, and in the name of God the Holy Spirit. Clap your hands for Jesus. Clap your hands for Jesus. Clap your hands for Jesus. I'm not motivating you. I'm telling you to clap your hands to Jesus. This is not motivation. Clap your hands to Jesus. Clap your hands to Jesus.
Holy are you, Lord, all creation call you, Lord.
Sing with me.
You're worthy, worthy is your name. We worship. We worship your majesty. Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord.
Creation.
Oh God, you
die.
Worthy
is your name.
words of the Father. Forever you remain. Just sing. You are the Lion and the Lamb. The words of the Father. Forever you remain. Just sing. You are the Lion and the Lamb. The words of the Father. Forever you remain. You remain. You remain. Just sing. Oh, you are the Lion and the Lamb. The words of the Father. Forever you remain. Mercies all over God. Be at the resurrection. You are the Holy One. There is none. Works of man, you are the only one. There is no one like you. Oh Lord our God, there are the works of man.
You are the only one.
heavenly language. Just the voice. He's a heavenly language. He's a heavenly language. He's a heavenly language. He's a heavenly. Hallelujah. That's what my song will be. That's what my song will be. That's what my song will be. Hallelujah. That's what my song will be. That's what my song will be. That's what my song will be. Hallelujah. To say hallelujah, that's all I have to say. Hey, that's all I have to say. That's all I have to say. Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
That's all I have to say.
That's all I have to say.
That's what my song will be. That's what my song will be. That's what my song will be. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh God, that's what my song will be. That's what my song will be.
That's what my song will be.
Hallelujah, indeed, will our song be unto you. We glorify you for bringing us tonight to hear from your word. We ask that, Lord, you will minister to us. You will speak to our hearts. That, Lord, your word will come and bring about transformation in our lives. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, blessed Redeemer, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you to the worshipers. Hallelujah. Tonight we want to thank the Lord for yet another opportunity to share with you. We want to thank God for the opportunity to share with you tonight. No special thanks to our senior pastors, Pastors Kayode and Femi Peter. We thank the Lord. Also for our resident pastor, Pastor Madi, who is here present with us. This evening, we will be looking at the topic, Living Your First Love. Living Your First Love. Living Your First Love. You know, the Bible talks about living your first love in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4. But our text this evening will be taken from Revelation 2, verses 1 to 5. Revelation 2, verses 1 to 5. CMM, please help us. Revelation 2, 1 to 5. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Verse 2. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. Verse 3. And hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Verse 4. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Verse 5. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. Praise the Lord. So this evening we'll be looking at living your first love. St. John the Divine, who had this revelation and wrote this revelation, it was a letter to the church of Ephesus, the Ephesian church. He was writing to them. And if you look at this letter, the beginning of the letter was full of praises for the church. If you look at what we just read, he says that they cannot bear them which are evil. They have tried them which they say they are apostles, and they are not. They have found them liars. They have labored and have not fainted. But he told them in verse 4, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. They were praised for all the good things they were doing. But he now said, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. So tonight, we'll be looking at what it means to leave your first love. This is a very serious thing. The church in Ephesus was praised for their good works, all that they had done. But in verse 4, he told them, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. What is it that you have against them? He said, they have left their first love. So tonight, we'll be looking at, what does it mean to leave your first love? What does it mean to leave your first love? What is your first love? It's like when you're married, women are in the habit of, accusing their husbands that it's not the same way. When you came to marry me, it's not the same way that you loved me that you love me now. That kind of a thing. Now, the Ephesian church were being told that they have left their first love. What is this first love? The love, the zeal, the commitment, the excitement you have when you first received Christ. That is the first love. That zeal. Jesus said, the zeal of thy house hath consumed me. In John 2 verse 17, he said, it is written that the zeal of the house of God has consumed me. The zeal of the Lord. When we first gave our lives to Christ, We were zealous for the Lord, doing things for him. When they say it's time for fellowship, you'll be the first that will be there. When they say there's need for money in the church, it's time to give, you will give. You will outgive other people. You make sacrifices. When they say it's time for evangelism, you will come out. When you go out, you see people who do not know Christ, you witness to them. That is your first love. But now, where are you? Are you like the Ephesian church that we are told that they have left their first love? It's a serious matter, because in that letter they were praised. They were praised for the good things they had done. And in verse 4, it says, "Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love." May we not leave our first love, in the name of Jesus. So your first love is the initial zeal, the initial excitement, the initial commitment, the initial love you had for Christ when you gave your life to Christ. I don't know, how many of us, understand what we're saying, or you have witnessed this. You understand what we're saying about this first love? Sometimes we see that we have grown cold. We're no longer operating at that level. Praise the Lord. So verse 5 of our text says, "Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent." Remember therefore whence you have fallen. Remember where you have departed. Remember where you have backslidden. Remember where you are no longer hot. Remember those areas. And do the first works. Go back to the first love. That love that you had for Christ when you first believed. That is the first love. Praise the Lord. These are the things you were known for when you first believed. When you first believed, the things you were known for when you first, believed. Things like prayer, you were not joking with prayer. You were not joking with Bible study. You were not joking with evangelism. You were not joking with giving. And so many other things that you were doing when you first gave your life to Christ. But today, how are you with those things? Have you left your first love? Have you left your first love? Praise the Lord. I want to briefly talk about quiet time, as the Lord would have me speak on quiet time, very briefly. Quiet time, also known as morning devotion, is one area that many believers have left their first love. Quiet time. Many believers have left their first love in that area. Because of the hustle and bustle in the city where we stay, we explain it away. We rationalize it. We try to justify that we are not doing quiet time. But quiet time is very key in a believer's life. If a believer wants to have victory over sin, victory over Satan, victory over circumstances, you cannot joke with quiet time. You cannot joke with quiet time. In that area, many believers have left their first love. The quiet time is they wake up, I mumble just prayer for 2-3 minutes, and they move. You start to face the day without getting prepared. Quiet time is very critical for a believer. And the Bible tells us of the master that we are following. You know, the Bible says that Jesus is our perfect example. Mark 1 verse 35. Our master, who is the quiet, who is the perfect example, never joked with quiet time. He never joked with it, because he knew that was the secret of his victory. He could not start his day without quiet time. So when we wish away quiet time, or when we don't spend time before God in the morning to start the day, it is not good. Because you cannot achieve victory for that day the way you ought to. And the Bible says, Mark 1:35, and in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. And there prayed. Very important. How can you start the day? How can you face the day and you expect to achieve victory when you don't settle it in prayer? And you say, oh, I have to leave my house by 5 if I must get to work before 7. Yes, find a way to still spend time in the morning having your quiet time, meditating in the scripture, spending time to pray so that you can achieve victory. Many of us have stopped that. That's one of the ways that we have left our first love. Our communion with God is no longer what it used to be when we first believed. Praise the Lord. Now, moving on, the topic is living your first love. You know, what are the signs of living your first love? What are the signs when you see people who have left their first love? Like the, you know, Ephesian church was being told, where we read in Revelation, that they have left their first love. And it was considered a very serious matter. They were praised for the many good things they had done. But he said, nevertheless, you have left your first love. And he told them to repent. Otherwise, there will be a problem. What are the signs? What are the signs of leaving your first love? When we leave our first love, what it means is that we have begun to compromise in our faith. We have started compromising in our faith. You know, things are no longer the way it used to be with us when we first believed. Number one, somebody who has left his first love is filled with his own ways. He's filled with his own ways. You tell him, you know, something, he said, no. I don't take instructions from people. I take instructions from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is here to tell me that. He's filled with his own ways. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 14. He says, the backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways, and a good man shall be satisfied from himself. The backslider in heart, the man who has left his first love, shall be filled with his own ways. He's filled with his own ways. He does not take advice, no counsel. He's filled with his own ways. It's what he thinks that is right, that he believes. He does not give room for counsel, for advice. That is number one sign. Number two, absence of prayer and the word of God. absence of prayer and the word of God is another sign of somebody who has left his first love. There is absence of prayer, absence of studying the word of God. But Peter knew it. Peter, the apostle, knew it. And that was why Peter said in Acts chapter 6, verse 4. Acts chapter 6, verse 4. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Peter knew it. He says, we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Once this is absent in your life, you have left your first love. May that not be our portion in the name of Jesus. Another sign of somebody who has left his first love is that he does not witness for Christ anymore. There's no more urge to talk to people to repent. There's no urge to bring people to the kingdom. There's no urge anymore. The person has left his first love. You see a believer in the midst of unbelievers, people that you need to speak to about Christ, he will close his mouth. He will close his mouth. He can't talk to them about Christ. Even to invite them to church. You see him, you will not know that he's a Christian. When people say, but that one is a Christian. Say, eh? I don't know. He doesn't behave like one. Somebody who has left his first love. He does not witness for Christ. Lack of witnessing for Christ. Telling people about Christ is not his business anymore. Another sign of somebody who has left his first love. Another sign of somebody who has left his first love is that there is no urge to attend church. No urge to attend fellowship. He's not interested anymore. He can use the time for fellowship to do other things. No urge. No desire. Hebrews 10 verse 25. He says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. When we get so busy in the world, we forget that the day is approaching. There will be a day. There will be a day. Christ will still come back. Christ shall return. But when we get enmeshed with worldliness, we forget about the coming back of Christ. That is another sign. He says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. It did not start today. In the early church, it was there. He says, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. We're looking at the signs of somebody who has left his first love. Another sign of somebody who has left his first love is worldliness. The love of the world. Worldliness is a major sign of somebody who has left his first love. The things of God are not interesting to the person anymore, but it's worldly things that matters to the person. And the Bible says that friendship with the world is enmity with God. The friendship with the world is enmity with God. So you can see. In James 4 verse 4, it says, Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Says, whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. That is another sign. You are worldly. Worldliness. The Bible gave an example with Demas. You know, Paul, in writing to, you know, Timothy, was explaining 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10. In the 2 Timothy 4, verse 10. He says, for Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica, Christians to Galatia, and Titus to Dalmatia. For Demas has forsaken me. Demas is no longer interested in the things of God. He forsook Paul. Paul said, having loved this present world. So worldliness is a sign of living your first love. Praise the Lord. Are we together, please? Another sign of somebody who has left his first love is somebody who has a root of bitterness. You know, bitterness is like a root. It grows a taproot inside and is difficult to uproot. Root of bitterness against people, unforgiveness, malice, all that is evil. Root of bitterness. And the Bible tells us something in Hebrews 12, verse 15. Hebrews 12, verse 15. It says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Root of bitterness. Root of bitterness. Malice. Unforgiveness. You know, bitterness. Grudge. All forms of evil you are carrying in your heart, and it has taken root in you. He says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. God has called us by his grace as Christians. He said, lest you fail of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Praise the Lord. Are we too fast, please? Another sign of living your first love is the Christian, when they talk about fasting, you gratify so much of the flesh. Fasting, you don't ever want that at all. Anything that has to do with praying and fasting, no. Mm-mm. You don't ever want it. But Jesus told us in Matthew 6, verse 16, moreover, when ye fast, he didn't say if you fast. Where it is assumed that it is a given. It is a constant. You know, mathematicians talk about constant K. It's a constant, it's given. He says, moreover, when ye fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. When ye fast, it's assumed that you will be making out time from time to time to fast, to pray. Say, when ye fast, not if you fast. Another sign of living our first love is general lukewarmness. General lukewarmness. Lukewarmness. We are not hot. We are not cold. Lukewarm. Lackadaisical. Neither here nor there. Non-commitment. General lukewarmness. Revelation 3 verse 16 says, so then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. May that not be a portion in Jesus' name. He says, because thou art lukewarm and you are neither hot nor cold, I will spew you out of my mouth. General lukewarmness as a Christian. It's a sign of leaving your first love. Another sign of leaving your first love is unequally yoked relationships. Unequally yoked relationships and lack of separation. Unequally yoked relationships and lack of separation. What do we mean? We'll see it from the scriptures very soon. Unequally yoked. But you know, the Bible talks about light and darkness. Can they be together? No. Christ and Belial, can they be together? No. Unequally yoked relationships. The Christian who has left his first love gets into unequally yoked relationships. You see a beautiful sister in the choir. Decent sister, born again. You know, tomorrow she comes with somebody that she wants to marry. Say, this is the person I want to... Wow, wow. That's good, great. What church do you attend? They just mention one church, like, you know, like that. I don't want to call any church. They just mention one church like that. That you begin to wonder, sister, so you didn't see anybody in this church or one of the, you know, Pentecostals where people are being taught about Christ and all that? Or the person will say, it's from the other religion. Unequally yoked relationships. It's a sign of lack of living your first love. What happened? How did this come to be? 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 and 17. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Verse 17. He says, wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So we're talking about unequally yoked relationship. It's not only in marriage, it can be in business. You see, a believer, he gets into an alliance with some unbelievers. Business alliances with unbelievers. I begin to wonder, brother, are there no, you know, men in this church that you could have gone into partnership with? Unbelievers who don't believe what you believe. When the time comes, you say that, they will tell you, but you know, we just need to, you know, some of these people that you see, they go to some of the native doctors to, you know, pay homage and, secure their business and all that. I think we need to do that. You say, but I'm a Christian, I cannot do it. It's late. You have gone into the partnership already, and that's what they want to do. You don't want to do it, but they want to do it. So you see that, ab initio, you should have checked out these things. Should have checked out these things from the very beginning. So unequally yoked relationships find expression in so many ways. So many ways. It finds expression in so many ways. So for you as a Christian, you need to be careful and know what you are doing. You know, finally, another sign of somebody who has left his first love is that lying is nothing to you. I said, your phone rings. I said, where are you, sir? Where are you, sir? You are in Aja. I just, turned across the third mainland bridge now. I'll soon be there. I said, is this not a brother telling this kind of lie? And they say, it's nothing. It's nothing. Lying is the order of the day. They feel nothing about it. They couldn't bat an eyelid. They lie. Unbelief. Revelation 21 verse 8 says, but the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and warmongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That is a sign of losing your first love. You have forgotten the Christ that you have believed. Hebrews 3 verse 12 says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Say, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Unbelief is another example, just like lying. Unbelief. You know, the Bible says, what thing soever is not done of faith is what? Sin. What thing soever is not done of faith is sin. So, brethren, I took time to bring out these because the Ephesian church was praised for the good things they were doing, where we just read. And as I was reading it, you would think that, oh, wow, this is a wonderful pass mark. Until he said, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. And that just overran all the good things that they had done that they were praised for. He says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Because thou hast left thy first love. May we not leave our first love. My prayer tonight is that as we have heard this message, we will mix it with faith. We will not leave our first love. Our lives will be transformed in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. Can we take some comments and questions and contributions? Praise the Lord. Yes, there's a hand that is up here.
Praise the Lord. Thank you so much, sir, for the leading of the Holy Spirit and today's topic that you have shared with us. I don't even know whether it's a question or contribution, but you keep my heart heavy as you are preaching, because I remember vividly, or what I want to say firstly, that what was the reason why you connected yourself to Christ at first? Because once you have forgotten that reason, what brought you to Christ, it will be very, very difficult for you to keep connecting with him. I love a practical life. If because you are looking for a husband, that's the reason why you gave your life to Christ. Once you have gotten that husband, the tendency that you will continue to stay in that Christ and not deviate from him that ratio is very lean. That is one. I remember in 1997, that was the first time I gave my life to Christ. And my pastor in our local environment then, he will say this in Yoruba, even though I'm going to interpret it. He said, every Sunday when you finish, he will tell you that, let the peace of God be with the holy people. Then I began to have this trouble in my heart. Who are the holy people? So what then is going to happen to the people that are not holy as they are going into the week? Does that mean that the peace of God will not be with them? That was what brought me to Christ, 1997. So once we have forgotten the equilibrium points that we met with Christ, it will be very, very difficult for us to reconnect back. So I think that is my contribution.
Yeah, thank you. Let's have more questions, contributions, comments. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'll take my contribution from the book of Hosea 6:7, which says, and I, the Lord, will hedge her ways with thorns. She will chase after her lovers, and she will not find them. And she will then say to herself, I will go back to my first love, for it was better with me then than now. So, if we see that things are not going the way it's supposed to be, the next thing we need to do is we should check back what we have done. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. And she shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them. And she shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for it was better with me then than now. So if we discover that things are not going the way it's supposed to be, we should sit back and check. If we are disconnected, let us go back for reconnection. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Yes, do we have more comments, please? Yes, sir. Pastor wants to make a comment, please.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I just like to take a bit from what the contribution of our brother, when he said that if you do not know what brought you to Christ, it is very easy for you to leave the first love. I do know that many of us came to Christ for several experiences, based on different experiences. But when you come to Christ, God can use any experience, life experience, to draw you onto Him. But it is also important that when you come to Christ, so for instance, if husband is the reason, or getting a wife is the reason why you came to Christ. Because there are sometimes people have the wrong reasons or a different reason for coming to God. But when they come to God, they eventually get, to stay, because something different experience has begun to change or started to change, and they are no longer able to live this life that they were living before. So they are able to say, okay, even though this is the reason why I came to Christ, but things are now happening in a different dimension in my life. Why do I say so? Bible tells us in 2 Peter 3:18 that we should grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So if I come to Christ as a child, I am expected, God expects me, that I grow in terms of knowing God, who God is, and the dimensions and aspects of God that will help me to be deeply rooted in God. So it is at that time, if I begin and continue to do that, as part of one of the scriptures you reference in Hebrews 10:25, says, if I do not forsake the assembly of brethren, and I continue to seek knowledge, then I begin to get deeper and deeper into who God is and His Christ. And that helps me also to begin to develop the understanding and the muscles that I need to be a different believer than who I was, even at the time that I was coming unto Him with an intention that was not genuine and real. But God allowed it to be so. But if I give myself unto all of that, into all studying, into prayer, into, you know, fellowshipping with the people of God, different things can happen in my life, and then I can be deeply rooted, and then it'd be difficult for me to go back to my first love. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Yes, more comments? Yes, there's a hand up there. Okay, there's a hand up there too.
Okay, praise God. It's a question. During your teaching, sir, you mentioned being unequally yoked with unbelievers. So my question is it that is a sin, or having been in a partnership with unbeliever makes you to leave your first love, for instance? Because nowadays it seems a bit difficult to even do business with some so-called Christian now. Because one of the first things once they tell you, I'm a Christian, you are going to let down your guard. And the next thing, they can hurt you really, really, really hard. But unbelievers now seems to be like, oh, they are straightforward. Yes, I know they are going to the other side to do one or two things, to secure their businesses and all that. But what happened to so-called Christian now? They are not even holding on to the faith. They are not proclaiming the Christ they said they believe in, because you want to be in business with them. So my question now is, doing business with unbeliever, does that make you to leave your first love? Thank you.
Okay, that question will be answered not by me, but we will throw it before our very senior pastors who are here, who would also need to talk. I don't know. There was a lady who wanted to ask a question. Maybe you talk before we go to the question. Yes, please.
Thank you very much, sir, for the teaching. Okay, one is a contribution. The second is a question. The first one, which is a contribution, is this.
Can you put the mic?
Okay, the contribution I have is this. From the teaching you just completed, I can see that there's a very thin line between being connected to Christ and being disconnected from Christ. You mentioned that from the scriptures, from Revelation, where you read that the church at Ephesus, they were first praised by the Lord, that praised for their good works. And then later on, he told them that they had left their first love. So the contribution there is this. Someone can be a Christian and you're doing all of the good things. If you do not take care, you can easily be disconnected from him. Why you still think, because of the good works you are doing, you are still where you're supposed to be. So what that tells me is that there's the need for us to always do a soul search. The Bible says that let him that think that he stands take heed lest he fall. So there is a need for us always to do that check inside of us. Am I still there? Am I still doing all of the things that are expected of me? So that we won't just say, because, oh, I'm very active in church, I do all of the activities, and I do all of the things, I'm still there, not knowing that the person has actually backslided. So my prayer is that God will help each and every one of us, so that at the end of the day's journey, it will not be depart from me, O ye workers of iniquity. So the second one is a question. You have given us a list of things, the signs that show that someone has left his or her first love. The question there is this: must one exhibit all of this to show that the person has departed from or has left his or her first love? Or would just one out of this lot, and maybe many other one, show that the person has actually left his or her first love? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Very interesting questions. Our brother asked his question that we're talking about unequally yoked relationships. There are people who we say are Christians, but they're neither here nor there. Am I not better off to join in an unbeliever? That unbelievers are straightforward. Abby? And all that. Maybe I want our pastor, Mommy Harokode, to help us answer his question before we go to the other question. Yes, ma'am.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I want to take the answer from the last Holy Ghost service with our daddy and the Lord Daddy Gio. When daddy was talking to workers, and daddy asked a question, among all the pastors, if one is a bad one, does it mean all pastors are bad? We answer, no. If someone is working contrary to the will of God and is a pastor, does it mean all pastors are working contrary to the will of God? We say no. I want to believe. Don't be unequally yoked. Some Christians are good and some are not, and vice versa. So it's all about, you cannot use one to condemn others. But the way the Bible says it is that as a Christian, if you want to, like in marriage, make sure you marry someone on the same faith with you so that you don't have so many differences, so many complications. You pray together, you talk alike, you understand things together. And I think it's also applicable in business. So I don't want to believe that because one Christian is bad, other Christians are bad. I can only talk for myself. I just
yes.
think so.
Okay, we'll come to you, Pastor Christy. My brother, does it make sense to you? It doesn't make sense. Okay. Pastor Christy, can you help in that area, please?
Praise the Lord. You first of all need to understand what it means to be yoked. Now, when you see two cattle that are yoked together, it means that if one moves this way, the other one must move that way. So when it says that you are yoked in any relationship, whether it is business, marriage, whatever, what it means is that you are bound by the decisions and the actions of the other party. So if you are in a business relationship, whether it's with a Christian or non-Christian, whatever that other party does in that relationship, you are also held accountable as having done it. So when you know this at the back of your mind, you now have to ask yourself, do I want to be in a relationship with somebody who does not have the same ideals, the same faith, the same convictions that I have? Or who is, like you said, is going somewhere else and is bringing those practices into your business? Do you want to be held accountable for those actions? Then let that guide you. Let's not play with it. Because whatever that other party does, whether it's in marriage or it's in business, you are held accountable as having done it. That is what it means to be yoked. So when you are going into whatever kind of relationship, think. Think and think again. And ask, let God lead you. Let the Holy Spirit guide you into what it is you are going to do. Believe you me, at the end of the day, it is better for you to be with a believer that shares your faith, that shares your beliefs. Mommy has said it. Yes, not all believers are believers. Some people are just churchgoers. But let the Holy Spirit lead you into the relationship that is beneficial for you, for your spiritual being, well-being at the end of the day. Praise God. And then my sister that spoke over there before we leave, you know, because I actually wanted to speak on that. When she said, must we be fasting? Must we be praying? Must we be fellowshipping? Must we be doing all this to show that, you know, we are with our first love? And I looked at that scripture again, and I read it in the Passion Translation. Okay, verse 5 in the Passion Revelation 2. It says, think about how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works of love you did at first. Repent and do the works of love you did at first. So what were those works of love you did at first? Was it not praying? Was it not going to church every service? When the call fast, was it not fasting? When the call vigil, was it not vigil? And when you gave your life, and I'm sure you were also occupied, most of us were equally occupied at the same time, but we did all these things. So what has stopped us from doing it? What has stopped us? There is no excuse. That's why it says repent. Repent. We like to come up with excuses that, yes, I'm much more busy than I was 20, 30 years ago when I gave my life. Therefore, I can't wake up in the morning any longer. I can't fast twice a week any longer. I can't. No. The word of God is clear and is very clear. You may not be doing it for the whole world to see, but God sees. God sees. So when it says repent, it means that all of us in this room, me inclusive, we need to check ourselves. The things we used to do when we gave our lives, passionately, zealously, nothing. It's the flesh that has stopped us. Let's face facts. So let us look inward and repent and go back. Praise the Lord.
Okay. Pastor, what is your verdict, please? Our time is fast spent. Okay, say what you want to say in 1 minute, please.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We can see clearly. Thank you, Jesus. The world is in the church, and the church is in the world in this our own time. There's no hiding again with all what we have been hearing. Thank you for the topic, sir. He's talking to all of us. We can see in the book of the Revelation, chapter 2, when our Lord Jesus was revealing everything to John, beloved. Now, if you look at it, before he reached, when he joined to chapter 4, before I jump to chapter 4, you could see clearly that we could not able to hear them, any of these churches again. Now, he's now talking to us how we can help ourselves out. Please, this is not the time we can judge. Be the church of the last time. We all, especially Africa, Nigeria, the whole world is waiting for us. So we have work to do to help ourselves out. There's no excuse of judging anybody. We have to work to manage ourselves, to know what this one is passing to or what that one is passing to help ourselves go. May God help us in Jesus' name.
Amen. Okay, shall we pray? Our Father, we thank you tonight for the opportunity to hear from your word. We ask Almighty Father that the Holy Spirit, the great teacher, will interpret the scriptures to us. We ask that every one of us here present will mix the word we have heard with faith, and that our lives will be transformed, and that we'll be prepared for heaven. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's stretch forth our hand to our daddy that bless us. Let's thank God for the word that came from the throne of grace this hour. The word to illuminate our life with his light. Let us pray the virtue that came out of him, that God will replenish him multiple fold in Jesus' name. And that God will keep him rooted in him till the end. In the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we say thank you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the Lord. It's time to give our offering. Giving is living. When we call for giving, do you grumble? That's one of the signs of living your first love. God gave us his only begotten son. And we are today in his presence, enjoying all the privileges. Giving is living. You have the opportunity to give because you are alive. Those that has gone to the grave, they don't have the opportunity. So let's package up our offering to appreciate the faithfulness of God in our lives. You can pay via POS at the back of the church. You can do transfer through our bank details on the screen, and you can give cash. But preferable, you can do the bank transfer. You are all welcome. Let's be on our feet as we give cheerfully.
Darling Jesus, oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. I love you so, my darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. Darling, darling Jesus, darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. I love you so, my darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. Darling Jesus, darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. I love you so, my darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. Darling Jesus, darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. I love you so, my darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. Darling Jesus, darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord. I love you so, my darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus, you're a wonderful Lord.
Our daddy and our God, we say thank you for another opportunity you have given unto us to give. How much can we give to quantify your love over us? Daddy, this hour, we brought our token to express our appreciation for all you have done for us. We say thank you in Jesus' name. Accept us and accept our offering. Let it be used to expand your kingdom on earth in the name of Jesus Christ. And those that ask nothing to give you, Daddy, open doors of heaven unto them. Enlarge their course and bless the works of your hands. Next time they come to your presence, give them seeds to sow to your glory and to the shame of the devil. Thank you for her writing. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Let somebody shout a glorious amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's be seated. In our mix today, if today is your first time of fellowshipping with us in this sanctuary, can you just wave your hand? You are here for the first time today. Thank you, my brother. Can you be upstanding? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Can you just help me to appreciate him? You are welcome to the presence of God. This is Redeemed Christian Church of God, Tabernacle of David, Region 51. A place where God colors all labels with his favor. So your being here today is not by mistake. You will know that through the teaching, you are blessed. So we implore you, if you don't have a place of worship, this is the best place to worship. And God bless you. You are welcome. God bless you. Please, let's endeavor to invite our neighbors anytime we are coming from the Gende. Praise the Lord. If you are blessed today, can you wave your hands to the King of Glory? And please, thank you. Let's be upstanding as we take the closing prayer. I just want you to... Oh, there's a song God gave to me. I will never, never go back to the world. Never go back to the world. Never go back to the world anymore. Say it with your heart. Sing it.
I will never ever
go back to the world. Never go back to the world.
Never go back
to the world anymore.
The song is just telling God your commitments, that since you have accepted him as the first love, you will never be disconnected from his presence. Because you have tested God, God is good. You've tested God, God is perfect. You've tested his love is the best. If you believe that, shout hallelujah. Just raise up your hand and say, Father, thank you. Because I've tested you, you are the best in everything. There's no other God. All other gods are the works of men. I want you to pray and say, Father Lord, since you have tested him and you have promised you are not going to go back to the world, you will not leave your first love. Pray and say, God should grant you the grace to be zealous for him, to be committed to the end, to be excited in his service and in his presence. Every grace you need, God will give unto you. Nothing will separate you from that first love, and you will never be disconnected. In Jesus' mighty name. And so, Heavenly Father, we say thank you for tonight. Thank you for your word from your throne of grace, your word of life, your word that has illuminate our darkness, to check our life. Where we are today? Have we left our first love? Are we still in right standing? Have we derailed? And therefore, Father, this hour, we dedicate our life unto you. The grace to be committed to the end released upon us. The grace to be zealous released upon us. The grace to be fervent in our service to you, given unto us in the name of Jesus Christ. Nothing will separate us from you. Nothing by the special grace of God. Father, encourage us and uphold us for your glory. Daddy, we pray, as many that are disconnected from the first love, and they are here in our midst today, or in our families, or in our church, Daddy, we stand in gap for them. The power of restoration that brought you from death back to life, let it bring them back to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Restore their first love. Forgive them. Accept them in your presence in the name of Jesus Christ. And the remaining of us, help us to serve you to the end. And let us make heaven to your glory, to our blessing, and to the shame of the enemy. Father, we say thank you. As we pray in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Shalom. See you on Thursday by the grace of God. God bless you. Same time.